The goal of most data architectures is to bring your data into a single source of truth. That could be NoSQL, maybe it's other relational databases or files. The difficulty is that these could be different data types, different connection strings and APIs that you have to connect with, which can really make it challenging to get it to one place. Data Factory is Azure's way of simplifying this process to move your sources into some sort of destination. Let's look at this a little more closely on how this actually works. On the left, we have a source, and on the right, we have a destination, which is also referred to as a sink. Each of these will be programmed with some sort of connection. Think of that connection string. And then within Data Factory, we're going to create what's called a linked service. For example, blob storage or SQL database. Next is a data set, and that will be what's stored in memory to be moved along the way. It's going to take the data from that connection and that linked service and put it into something that can be worked with. And the same is true on the destination side. So we'll have that linked service and data set. And the connection point here is what's called the activity. And that's really where the magic happens to connect those two data sets and those two connection points together and do whatever activity you want to do. So we know it's moving from source to destination in that manner. With that said, let's think of an example. We covered some of this already, but for example, we could have a connection here on the left. That's a JSON object trying to get into a specific SQL table. The link service for the source connection could be blob storage, and for the database, Azure SQL. And what we can do as an example here is just copy that data from the source to the destination. And while this is a simple example, the concepts are what you can build on for any activity. The other thing to point out here is we create these linked services, but they're actually reusable. So just because in this case, the blob storage link service is going to that SQL database, there's nothing stopping it from being used in a different activity and going to a completely different connection. The other thing to understand is the context of how all of this stuff is actually happening. And when we think about this baseline flow here of activity, this is what's called the integration runtime. So we'll see this as we go into the demo. You can have different activities happening within a specific runtime. And again, you'll see how that looks. If you go up one more level, you're within a pipeline. And finally, above that is a data factory. So you have the factory, pipelines within a factory, and integration runtime within that. With that said, let's get into the demo now, and we'll create this actual flow that we see here. So here I am now back in Azure. We're in the portal homepage. What we'll do is say create a resource. This is going to fall under integration, because think about what's actually happening. We're integrating these different sources. And here we see Data Factory. You can either click create right here, or we can click on Data Factory and it'll take us to the same initial page. We'll go through the process now to create the Data Factory. Again, that high level container. Subscription, we're going to do the only one I have, which is KDS Demo. I did rename this from previous videos, so if you're following along, that's why that's a little bit different. Resource group, we have one already created. Region, and then now we need to give this factory instance a name. Version, there's different versions, but you want to just do the one that's recommended. Next, here we have Git integration, which is actually a really great feature because it allows you to configure a repository to version control all of the stuff that you're doing. We'll set this up later. So we'll say configure Git later. Next is networking. We're going to keep this as is for the sake of demo. Same with advanced tags. We'll get through this and go ahead and create our data factory. This was now created. We have our factory created, and let's go to resource. The first thing I'm going to do before we go in and build is make sure my source and target are actually set up, those different components. So we have the blob storage and the SQL table. I opened up a new tab here. I'll go to my blob storage. This should be here, but I'll just show you what it looks like. And this was created in a previous video. We have demo container. And here we have this persons list. And it looks something like this. Very simple, name, hometown, that's it. We want to take this and put it into a database table. So now if we go to our database and we can go to query editor, I'll log in as my user. And there's only this test table, but what I want to do real quick is actually create this persons table, which is where we're going to land that JSON object. So here's the query that I'm going to run, and go ahead and run this. And now if we refresh, we can see this persons table is here. It's empty. And now we have something where we can land that JSON file. Okay, so back to our data factory. What we're going to do is open up the Data Factory Studio. And this will give us a canvas and all these different options to now build out that pipeline and integration runtime that we want to do. right away here, we have all of these different options. We'll just start with new pipeline. And here we are. This is the main screen of Data Factory, where if you're an engineer, you're likely going to be spending most of your time in here working, building stuff. So let's go ahead and now create our first pipeline. We'll call this demo pipeline. And we can see it's here. Here's all the activities. You can see there's all different things you can do here. We'll cover these more extensively in different videos. But what we want is copy data. So we'll take this and just drag it on here. If you've worked with SSIS, it's a very similar feel, just with some more modern functionality. First thing we'll do is give this activity a name. We'll call this copy person's data. You can add more descriptions, timeouts, meaning how long will this be able to run before it times out, how many retries, how long between retries, et cetera, et cetera. All sorts of options. Now we need to configure our source, which is going to be that JSON. If we had a data set already set, we could select it here, but we don't because this is our first time. We'll go ahead and click new. Here are all the different options. You can see it's not just Azure. We have Amazon, Concur, Google Ads, all different things here. But what we want to focus on right now is Azure Blob Storage, because that's where that JSON object lives. Click that. Here's the format. For us, it's JSON. Continue. Now, what's the name of this data set? And we'll call this person's locations. Linked service. We don't have a linked service. Just to reset where we're at here, we've added this copy activity. We just added the connection for this JSON. Now we're creating the linked service for blob storage. And so that's where we're at right now. This is the name of our data set. Now let's create a new linked service. Now it's giving us a new window. We'll call this KDS blob storage. More options here that you can go through. What's nice here is because it's within Azure, you can use your subscription and built-in Azure functionality to connect, because it's all within the same ecosystem. We'll select our subscription and the storage account, KDS blob storage. That's where we found that file. And what we can do now is test this connection. Connection successful. Go ahead and create. Now we're back here to the data set. We've created the link service and it's asking, where can we find this file? If you know exactly what the container and directory is, you can put that in, or you can browse. And because it's connected, it just brings it right up for you. And here it is. And it's going to say, look in this path for this import schema, and now flipped to this option here. And we'll go ahead and click OK. All right. So now we have our source set up. We have the data set. We created that linked service to the blob storage. And now what we want to do is set up the sync, which again is another way of saying destination. And we're going to go through the same process here. It's asking if we want to use that same data set. Like we said, things are reusable. So you could technically use it here, but obviously that's not what we want to do. In this case, we're going to do an Azure SQL database. We'll do a new linked service, SQL database, subscription, demo. All of this is going to pre-populate because we're in the same ecosystem. Now here for authentication, you have different options. For us, what we're going to do is use the same user that I logged in here, which for me is mcon, because that's when we know we'll have permissions, and that's what we set up for this account. I'll go ahead and put that in here, and then the password. You can do encrypted, but if you do this, you're not going to be able to test the connection, which I'd like to show in this example, so we'll skip that and go ahead and test the connection, which brings up a good point here. Now, let's take a look at this error message. It's saying there's a firewall issue because the integration runtime doesn't have connection. This is another really good example of how security works on Azure. What we have to do is go in and give permissions to our database for this IP address to get there, because it's the IP within Azure of this data factory. We need to tell our database that, hey, it's okay that this IP comes in. So let's go ahead and do this. We're back in the database here. If we go set server firewall, rule name, we'll call this data factory, start IP. And I'm going to give this a range just in case there's some other subtly different IPs later on. So go ahead and save that. We're done here. We'll go back to the data factory. Now let's try again. Connection successful. It can get in. We're good to go. Create. All right. We're in table persons. It's going to import again and okay. All right. So we have our source, our sync data set. Now let's go to mapping. And what we can do here is import schemas, and that's going to look at our source and our sync and import all this in here. We can see name, and now we can pick the column here. So we have name, full name, hometown, we'll do location city. Now we are all set. Let's go ahead and try to run this. First, let's click validate just to make sure everything looks right. No errors, just a quick check. And what we'll do now is click debug, and debug is going to run this pipeline for us in debugger mode, which will give us some nice outputs. You see our pipeline run ID, refresh, comes down here, successful. We can look at the output. It's got some metadata here. This gives us some more visual on what's happening, which is pretty cool. You know, I don't know, makes a nice little visual on exactly what's going on. Now let's go back to our database and confirm that it's in there. If we go to tables, persons, to run this, and we see, okay, we have a record. So technically it did move, but if you think about it, we had three or four or maybe more records. It wasn't just one. And while you may not get this if you're working with CSV or maybe another file type, the reason we only got one in this case is because we're working with a JSON source. And because it's JSON, it's a nested object. It's a little more tricky. So what we have to do is go to mapping and go to this collection reference. And this is specific for JSON. And in this case, because we have it nested under a people array, which we can see, in order for it to know to iterate through all of those, we need to select this collection reference, and then it will know, okay, this is not just one record. We need to go through each of these in people and map them. So with that set now, let's go ahead and run this again. So we'll debug again. Another thing you can do is go to monitor over here, and you should see the different options. So we have triggered, which would be a little more real time, and debug is if you're running in debugger, which is what we've done, and the more recent one here. So let's take a look. We're back here. We can see all of this information. We're going to go back to author. So it was successful. Let's go back to our database, run again. And now we see we get the other options. But now we can also see that this doubled up. It gave us Steve twice in a row. And that's technically correct because we didn't say to do anything else. But if we don't want that to happen, we want it to be basically a truncate and reload every time. There's a quick way to do that. We click back on our activity to sync. And one option here is pre-copy script. And that's something you can run like it sounds before it copies if you want to update something or log something, whatever you want. In our case, we'll say truncate table dbo.persons so that it is truncating that. And it would just be a clean run. We would just get 1, 2, 3, 4 records. So with that now there, let's go one more time. Success. Let's run this again. And now we have 4. So it truncated, reloaded, and we're all good. Similar to SSIS, you can also select different paths. If you wanted to create something for a success path and put your next step, you would put something here. Here's the option to create something that happens on a failure, on completion, etc., and create that flow of your pipeline based on different outcomes. All right, what we'll do now is say publish all, and we're going to publish changes to a live environment. Publish, and if publish was successful, so now this is deployed on our data factory in a live setting. If we wanted to schedule this on some level, we could go into manage, go down to triggers, and add some different schedules. We won't do this, but this is where you can add a schedule on a different time, how often you want it to occur, and trigger these pipelines directly from data factory. That'll wrap up this video. I hope you now have a baseline understanding of how this works and can start to build out your own projects. Thanks for watching.